Because I'm already on Friday here. So I'll go ahead and convene the subcommittee meeting, and we have two of the three members on the line, present, so Dick Whitnell and Julia Brim-Edwards. Kay Turan is not present. We have, in addition to this the meeting today, we have a teleconference scheduled on Monday as well at 1 o'clock, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So we have a charge from the governor asking our subcommittee to create and propose a process and timeline for the recruitment selection of a permanent chief education officer. And so when I looked at the timeline, back mapped it from the time in which we need to have a new permanent person in place, which would be so the 1st of January, the 15th of January, necessitates a starting of the hiring process now, or approximately by October 1st. So I'm going to be recommending this afternoon that we pursue a two-phase process, the first phase being an expedited targeted process, and then a second phase, if needed, that would be a broader recruitment. And prior to starting the sort of a broader recruitment on the first, I think we should, and I would recommend we consider internal candidates. Having been through several sort of high-profile recruitments, if we're recruiting in the broader either state or national pool of potential candidates, most external candidates will be reluctant to engage in the process if they feel like they're competing with a qualified internal candidate. So it's going to be my recommendation, and I'd like Dick, sort of you're thinking on the consideration of a process that has two stages, and stage one be the consideration of qualified internal or pre-qualified candidates.
Oh, I agree totally. Just exactly how you outlined it.
Okay.
Phase two wouldn't go into play unless phase one did not produce that person that the board in general and the governor selected.
Correct. And what I'd suggest is that over the weekend, the next couple days, I'll draft a potential phase two process that we could consider on Monday, so that the outlines of what that would look like if we did go into a phase two broader recruitment, we'd have that sort of ready to go or in our sort of back pocket. An opportunity for there to be sort of broader subcommittee and board discussion on what that would look like, because obviously that potentially has resource requirements, different levels of engagement required from the board. So I think for that particular piece of the process would want maybe a longer discussion about it, but I can start sketching it out, what it would look like, so that we, if
Julia,
we have that.
Julia, how long do you feel that phase one would last? What's the timeline, do you think?
Well, given that, I say again, back mapping it from a January 15th or January 1st or a higher date, potentially some overlap with the current staff, is that it'd be extremely aggressive to have somebody in place even if we started on October 1st. So ideally, I'd like to have phase one completed by October 1st, just so that we can flip into the other phase if that's needed, because we'll lose probably the back half of December to the holidays, and we should be off and running 1st of October on a broader recruitment if that's necessary.
Right. I totally agree on just exactly how you outlined it, that the first phase would be the one that would be accelerated to say yay or nay, or if there is internal, and then after that, then that triggers a whole new, longer, elongated process.
Okay, and I think probably at this point it might be worthwhile to ask Gary if you have, are there any sort of parameters that we need to keep in mind either in phase one or phase two regarding the process?
Yes, thanks, Julia. You probably remember, and Dick, I don't know that we've met, but I helped the OEIB through its first year pretty extensively, and then more recently with the exit of the chief education officer. And what we did last time, just for context and very briefly, was to have the governor appoint a panel or a group that was not a subcommittee of the OEIB, and so therefore the screening process was not subject to the public meetings law. And there were, you know, private meetings and private conversations and private exchanges of documents and such that did not, that were able to preserve the confidentiality of applicants. But at the same time, Julia, you'll probably remember this, the OEIB as a whole did put in place the creation of a position description, obviously engaged in a very active advertisement through a national search, and adopted hiring standards, criteria, and policy at meetings open to the public where they could comment both on the hiring procedures that were being contemplated and the standards and sort of evaluative criteria that would be used. So that the reason that was done the last time was really to preserve the options of the body to have a confidential approach to the screening process. Because the only way you can hold an executive session, a non-public meeting, when you're going through the process is if it has done these preliminary, if the body, the OEIB, has taken these two preliminary steps. So Seth would have access to what was done last time and put before the OEIB. And that was, as I say, Julia, the position description and the overall approach for evaluation. So in the first phase, it sounds like you wouldn't be going that route, which means that any meetings with a candidate would likely not be subject to an executive session.
Okay, so they'd be public.
Right.
Okay.
So the deferral or the default is always public meeting unless there's a lawful reason to meet without public participation, and that would be the executive session rationale. That could be put in place for round two if it's needed by the OEIB, pretty much, I think, reformulating and bringing forward what was done the first time, probably, as what it thought were appropriate kinds of process and description for the qualifications of the candidates and how that evaluation would be made.
Okay. But for, so the guidance would be if you had phase two, but to potentially consider something that we utilized, like similar to what we utilized in the last recruitment, which was a working group. Phase one, if the subcommittee were to engage with any potential candidates or to have discussions about candidates, that we'd need to do that in a public setting or in a public forum. If there were a quorum, which would be, you know, two members of the committee present, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, well, that's, I think, pretty clear. Dick, do you have questions about that
process?
No, I don't.
Process? That's it.
Okay.
Ben,
thank you, Gary.
That, Jim, does that fit with your understanding of our discussion?
Yes, Gary, thank you.
Okay.
So, as Gary indicated, we had a fairly lengthy process last time in which we built a position description that reflected the roles and responsibilities that would have been laid out in the legislation that originally created this position. The working group met with maybe, I don't know, 15 to 20 stakeholder groups, and with the position description draft, they commented on it. I think in the end we had a position description that was an excellent tool that sort of guided the recruitment process and our thinking about the role of the chief education officer, and it's what we used when we made the decision to select Nancy as the interim. Dick, I would propose that we would utilize that again for the sort of phase one process, and then phase two, if we needed to get there, that we would do a broader check-in with the board, you know, see if it needs to be refreshed at all. But I think just having looked at it about a month and a half ago, it seemed still very sort of relevant and connected to the responsibilities that we believe the chief education officers should possess.
I totally agree. My understanding is this a true understanding that we make a recommendation to the board as a whole and the governor? Is that our challenge to look at the first phase, see if we have a person recommend our subcommittee recommend it to move forward?
Correct.
Right.
So
okay.
We could take if you're supportive, we take the position description. We'll, in a moment, have a discussion about any potential candidates. We would use that as a the benchmark for our discussions over this phase one. And ultimately, the committee would make a recommendation to, as you indicated, to the board and to the governor for full board action.
Perfect. Yes, that's my understanding. Good.
Ben, anything to add on just the process or the governor's perspective?
No, that's great, Julia. I think what you've described is consistent with his expectations for the process.
Perfect. So at this point, I'd like to shift to sort of the second item on our agenda, which is possible consideration of phase one candidates. And we can do this in two ways. Ben, I don't know if you, I know from the committee, from my perspective, I have a recommended candidate, but I want to know if the, would the governor like to recommend a candidate for the committee to consider in phase one?
The governor is, go ahead, Julia.
I was going to say, if not, we can proceed. I want to provide
right.
an opportunity.
Right. No, the governor is very much looking to the subcommittee's leadership in the process, and so I'll leave it to you too.
Okay, I would recommend that in phase one we consider Nancy Golden, who's the current interim.
I definitely would support that. I mean, I would very much so. And what especially what she has shown us the last 90-100 days.
Yeah, I think her work plan for the 6 months very aggressive, completely
yeah.
aligned with the board's work and the vision of I think the governor in 40-40-20. So I think she's a very strong, our analysis was when she was put forth as the interim, strong candidate for the position. Is there anyone else that, Dick, you think we should consider in phase one who would fit in sort of this tighter targeted pre-qualified position, or Ben, anyone the governor feels we should consider as well?
Without any person brought forward through the governor's office, and it sounds like they're leaving it to the subcommittee to move forward, I would, when it's appropriate, make a motion to move Nancy Golden forward to the consideration of the whole OEIB board slash governor.
Okay. Let's see. I don't think you actually formulated the motion, so I think we can still have a general discussion, but maybe I'll ask you for a motion in a moment. Ben, is there, I want to make sure, is there anyone, even given your previous statement, is there anyone else that we should look at? I think as the chair, I'd like to maintain the flexibility at least till Monday to potentially introduce other candidates, and certainly Kay, who isn't part of today's discussion, might have that option as well.
No, Julia, the governor will be very comfortable with limiting the consideration of Phase 1 candidates to Nancy Golden. I think he is very pleased for the subcommittee to be leading in that work, and so I preferred for that that suggestion to come from you and Dick, but I am very confident that that is consistent with, you know, his hopes and expectations.
Okay. Gary, a procedural point. Do we need a motion, or can we have it? It's a sense of the committee, and that on our meeting on Monday, we would continue to move forward.
Right. So let me understand. Is the meeting Monday just of the subcommittee?
It is.
Okay.
It's a teleconference again.
Right. There's. If you want to make it that no decision is made at this time, that's fine. I mean, alternatively, you could make a decision, and in that form, it would be however you want to make the vote tally known. So it's really your choice. There doesn't have to be a decision made at this meeting. It could be simply rolled forward to Monday to sort of summarize where it was left and then go from there.
Okay. Well, I think I would prefer, and Dick, maybe I could entertain a motion from you that recommends committee consideration of Nancy Golden in Phase 1, with the opportunity for the committee chair to potentially consider another candidate or candidates on Monday. I don't want to completely close it off, so I don't know if you could formulate that, but it's just so it's broad enough.
Sure. Just to say exactly what you said, and I move that Nancy Golden be the Personnel Management and Oversight Committee's,
recommend we consider her for...
Yeah, recommend we consider her for the... Yes, okay. For the CEO of the Organization Investment Commission, and that we will you want to put the part that you want to... our recommendation is Nancy Golden, but we're going to leave the process, is that right, open until Monday?
Yes.
Okay.
For additional candidates.
Julia, yeah, just as the scribe here, I'm attempting to keep a little log. I just want to make sure that I understand the motion correctly. I think the intent of the chair is that the motion express the committee's intent to consider Nancy Golden for possible recommendation to the full OEIB during phase one, with potential that the subcommittee would choose to add another candidate or candidates at its Monday meeting. I do not think that your intent, Julia, is that the motion is that the subcommittee actually make that recommendation today. I just want to clarify.
Correct. I think the way you phrased it is correct. That
I agree.
It's our intent to consider.
Okay.
I think it's important because it will send it, a clear message so that there's transparency of what our intent, our clear intent is.
Yeah.
To move her through phase one of the process.
Yeah.
But it's not okay. It is not at the point of we're recommending her to the board.
Right. Okay, I got it.
So I guess, and Gary, you can tell me if there's a different process. That'd be the second. Any discussion further, Dick?
Nope.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Just in terms of process, what I would suggest in terms of next steps is I'll put together a sort of feedback or sort of evaluative tool for the subcommittee, potentially the board, for phase one and phase two candidates. I'll provide a draft outline for a potential phase two if we need to go there. And then what I'd like to do, and Ben, since you, sounds like you were writing down the motion, I'd like to send by tomorrow, you know, close the business, an update out to the board on the committee's action so they're, you know, informed of the direction we're heading. So
yep.
If you could send off to me, that would be great. I'll sort of put together a short summary for your review, and then Seth, if we could get that out, that I'd appreciate it.
Julia, if OEIB is planning to send a bulletin, a more general bulletin tomorrow, are you okay with including this in a longer, as part of a longer bulletin, updating board members on OEIB's work?
You know, I'd like to do it separate just because I don't want it to get lost. Sometimes when I get, like, weekly updates, I get around to reading them a week later, and I'd rather not have people miss this. It'll just be a short, hopefully easy to read, here's where we are, what we're going to need from the board. Then the other question I would have, so that gets sent out, is the appropriate way to solicit Kay's feedback in that she receives the board update and can provide pre-Monday feedback if she so chooses, or knowing that that would all be obviously public record. But is that the mechanism?
This is Gary. Was she intending to participate in the Monday meeting?
She is. She's on the subcommittee. She just couldn't make today's meeting.
Right. Right. So it's not a meeting if there isn't, you know, deliberation towards or consideration of matters pending before the subcommittee, but And it's not a meeting if somebody simply replies by an email or something. We do broach the problem, though, of a quorum of a subcommittee if you and she start talking about that, for example.
Right. So that's what the mechanism would be. She'd get a summary like everybody else, and if she chose to send her comments back. I mean, again, it's a public record, however.
But it's not a public meeting.
Right, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I think that should be our plan in terms of next steps. Ben or Dick, do you have anything that you want to add in terms of what we need to do?
Oh, I think it's outlined, and I guess I have a mechanical question. Do we use this Seth, do we have the same phone-in numbers, or are we going to even give us new ones?
It's the same ones. You should have received a confirmation email yesterday about the Monday meeting. It actually came
okay.
in first, and it has all the information, but it is the same numbers.
Okay, got it. Okay, great. Good.
And Julie, may I say also there would be nothing wrong with having somebody other than you or Dick contact Kay to say that, you know, if she wanted to forward something to you before Monday, that would be appropriate.
Okay. Ben, does that sound like something that
yep.
you'd be willing to cover off on? Okay, perfect.
Yep.
One thing, Ben, I'm wondering, or potentially Seth, you might have this, is the last, given that I'm in China, did somebody have the last version of the position description?
I
think it was something like version 14.
I can look back in the records. I'm sure we have it somewhere. I will.
There were a number of different iterations, but by the time we got to the last stage, we had, I'd say it was numbered something like version 11 or 14. I just don't have it.
Julie, am I right that it was not updated this summer? The most recent version is the one that was used during the hiring that resulted in Rudy.
Yes. Okay. So when I looked at it prior to the appointment of Nancy to be the interim, I went back, looked at it. It still, I say, was current and fresh. So, and that's what we used to sort of match up as Nancy the right candidate for the interim.
And was it the one that we given to the board back?
It was.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we have. Yeah, I can get that. No problem.
Great. Because I'd like to circulate that along with sort of here's what we're using for phase one, and then we'll go back and like I say do a quick pass with people on if we had to do a broader recruitment. Is there anything we'd want to change?
But you don't want that to go out with the update tomorrow, correct?
Actually, if you had it, go ahead and send it to me, and I can see if there's if it's not too much. It may be more of a Monday update.
Gotcha. Okay.
I think at some point it'd be. People know that Nancy was vetted by that criteria when she was asked to be the interim. So that's. That speaks volumes to me that she has been vetted, plus what she has done since then till today. So this isn't a fast track type of situation. In one sense it is, but on the other sense we know the individual because they've been vetted and chosen to be the interim. So now we're making the second decision.
Right. We don't even know more about her than we know just about anybody else.
Exactly. That was going to say that. Yes, exactly.
Well, and I think when I circulate the position description, I say it's worth reminding the rest of the board, especially those people who weren't on the
yes.
work group. So from the board, Kay and Hannah and I were on the work group, but we really vetted that position description and built it in collaboration with lots of stakeholders, a very diverse group of stakeholders. So the position description, you know, I think is a great guide for us to use and, you know, match candidates against it or compare candidates to it because it was something that we spent, an instrument that we spent a lot of time developing as what we want in that individual.
And Julie, it seemed to me, and I don't know if this was separate, there was a one-page sort of CEDO deliverables. Was that married?
Oh, yeah, that was... yeah, that was another thing that we developed recently. I just was looking at it in the file. That is... Okay.
This is Ben. I think I believe that document is somewhat less fresh, or put another way, that Nancy and the board through the development and of both the strategic plan and Nancy's six-month deliverables has sort of significantly updated that.
That's good. Yeah, because we were looking at that with respect to what had transpired in the prior year.
Right.
It was a year old.
Yep.
Yeah, well, I think what I sort of one of the things over the next 3 to 4 days before the Monday call would be to sort of put all these pieces in place so that there was a considerable amount of work previously done that we can utilize certainly in phase one and in phase two, and that part of it is resharing them with the board and answering any questions, but it's not like the process is being started with a blank slate like we in position
yeah,
we
were
in a year and a half ago.
Yeah, we're not reinventing the wheel here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I noticed how I work in that car thing. That's
mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just had to leave, speaking of cars, Dick, leave Singapore before the Formula One races started this week.
Oh, yeah, right. Huh.
All of downtown Singapore is set up for Formula One races.
Wow.
But I'm gone from there now.
Okay.
Anything else for the committee's, subcommittee's work between now and next Monday?
So, Julia, just to clarify, you're going to work on something for us to send out to the board tomorrow, updating them on this afternoon's meeting and next steps. Is that right?
Correct. And then I guess whatever notice that needs to happen for the Monday call.
Yeah, we're fully noticed
sure
for Monday.
Out. Okay, perfect.
Full notice for
Monday. All right.
Will you send your, whatever you write up, will you send to me, and then I'll get it to Seth for
yeah, dinner. Absolutely.
Okay.
Just for what it's worth, it's going to probably come sort of mid-afternoon your Friday.
Okay.
Just because of my time difference.
Yep.
Okay.
Hey, Julia, thanks
for your time and for doing this on sort of a tight timeline. Appreciated it.
Appreciate you.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Be safe. See ya.
Thanks.